Our next guest, he is Shahid Buttar, and he is running for Congress. And it's great to see you again. You ran for Congress in 2020. I think you are the biggest challenge to Nancy Pelosi in the history of her career, right? You're running to take Nancy Pelosi's congressional seat. Welcome, Shahid Buttar.
Thank you, David, for the welcome. It's great to be with you again. And yeah, just to respond to your question there, yeah, the strongest challenge that Pelosi's ever faced was our 2020 campaign when we won 81,000 votes. And we're looking forward to building on that and liberating our city's voice in Washington and getting us a representative in Congress who stands for human rights and global peace and justice instead of the corporate corruption of Congress.
Well, I don't want to embarrass you, but it is an honor to have you on the show. The last time you were on the show, I didn't get to talk to you about the things that I really wanted to talk to you about. And you showed up at office hours. And that was fantastic. Friday night, it was you rolled up your sleeves and talked to a relatively small group of people. And it's a bottom up. It's not top down campaign. And I really appreciate you talking to my hardcore listeners at office hours Friday night. Go to shahidforchange.us, S-H-A-H-I-D, forchange.us. Give him money. Give him money. He is up against the Pelosi dynasty. And again, I'm a Democrat. But it's time for change. And Nancy Pelosi is not serving the American people. She is has at least $200 million. She is a landlord. She is not equipped to understand the needs of the 140 million Americans who are living at or below the poverty line. You said something at office hours, Shahid, that chilled me. Her plan is to have one of her kids replace her.
SF Gate has reported and publicly confirmed what has long been the subject of, and not even a secret at all. I was going to say an open secret, but that would be too charitable. Right. Christine Pelosi sits on the DNC, the Democratic National Committee. She's never been elected to a position outside it. She has been quoted, named by several news outlets, in addition to SF Gate, LA Times, CNN, as a potential successor to her mother. I find it interesting, particularly because what SF Gate predicted is that if Nancy is allowed to retire on her own terms, she will announce her retirement soon after winning this race. That will trigger a special election, not unlike the one that Nancy Pelosi won her seat in back in 1987, which was the last time she ever debated anyone. And this special election would, of course, favor her daughter because it would be on an accelerated timeline. Other campaigns would not have the chance to spin up muscle to combat her name recognition and fundraising muscle. And all that is to say, the only way to stop the dynastic inheritance of a congressional seat, what I see as either an immigrant or a constitutional lawyer from both perspectives subtly differently, as outright feudal aristocracy.
Right.
The only chance to stop that train from reaching the station is to deny Nancy the opportunity to retire on her own terms.
Right.
And I do frankly see, independent of the succession plan, which offends any notion of democracy, when I just look at the policy record of an incumbent with a long history of blocking human rights, for instance, to universal health care, voting and supporting every military spending increase in the last generation, slow walking the impeachment process towards Trump and then limiting them to let him off the hook, and funding his concentration camps, you know, every accretion of power that the NSA and the surveillance apparatus has gained, all of these things can be traced back to her tenure. And this is at the same time, of course, that Congress has abandoned affordable housing, frozen the federal minimum wage, repeatedly passed tax breaks, targeted tax breaks, favoring the wealthy. That's a policy record that demands accountability. And I'm eager to be an agent of that accountability and, again, make some different choices in Washington on behalf of my city.
Well, let's talk about the concentration camps, because that's a freighted word. The ICE detention camps are concentration camps. When they were called such, I think this was 3 years ago, some members of the Jewish community were offended. It took, I believe, I'm not sure which Holocaust museum and a team of about 150 rabbis to say, no, no, these detention centers are, by their very definition, concentration camps. You are rounding up and placing people of a specific nationality, a race of people who speak a certain language. You're rounding them up and detaining them. I just wonder, the only difference between some concentration camps, I don't think the Japanese internment was for profit. When we rounded up the Japanese, right. I don't think those concentration camps were for profit. I think Hitler's, they used the ones who they starved to death could go off and build ammunitions and earn a little money. What's happening with these detention centers, ICE detention? Do you support, first of all, getting rid of ICE?
Absolutely. Abolishing ICE is a human rights imperative. And I so appreciate you making the point that compared with the Japanese internment, in some respects, the contemporary mass detention of migrants and asylum seekers is arguably worse. You ask what's happening in the detention centers. One of the things happening in the detention centers is the forced sterilization of migrant women in custody.
This was in Georgia, right?
That's exactly right. And that is straight out of the Nazi playbook, frankly. These might not be death camps yet, but when you look at these kinds of definitional human rights abuses acknowledged around the world as a human rights abuse happening in our name with public resources, putting private dollars in corporate pockets. And that is the essence of fascism, when the denial and the derogation of human rights makes money for an industrial complex that is embedded in the state. That is definitionally exactly what fascism is. And it is not a far off future fear in the United States. In 2022, it is here. It is firmly established.
We taught Hitler eugenics. It was Oliver Wendell Holmes who said one generation of cretins is enough. They were talking about my grandparents. He was talking about my grandparents when he said one generation of cretins is enough. But Hitler, didn't they learn the eugenics program from the United States?
Well, the eugenics program and the genocide of indigenous Native Americans was, in fact, if I recall correctly, there were aspects of the American program that the Nazis thought were too kind, particularly the one drop rule. Figured that it would resign too many people in their own community to the disfavored status. So they couldn't go that far. They couldn't be as abusive as America was to our Black neighbors. And that is a horrifying comparison to acknowledge. And it is inescapably historically true. And when I look at our nation today, there's a longstanding reckoning now, a long overdue reckoning, I should say, with race that is happening and unfolding. And in some respects being wound back up as it is being unwound in the United States, across the United States, including right here in San Francisco, to make this point very clear. Our elected district attorney, Chase Boudin, is up for a recall election. He'll be on the ballot in the very same one that I'll be on against Nancy Pelosi.
When is the date of that, please?
June 7th.
Okay.
And we encourage every San Franciscan to register and participate and to oppose the recall of Chase. I see there being a great deal of demagoguery in the press, particularly in the local body politic here. So the clamoring about a crime wave in the context of an uptick from a historically low baseline. Right. And this reflects, to your point about private detention centers, the policing industrial slavery complex makes a lot of money for a lot of people at lots of different points in the process, from the Taser Corporation, which is the leading producer of body cameras, to the private prisons, which are directly analogous to the private detention facilities, to the tech companies, which are charging prisoners and their families through the nose for things like to use this very same digital infrastructure that we're using right now.
To make a phone call, it's like $8 a minute or something like that. It's obscene. Boudin is the district attorney, and he's part of this new wave. There aren't too many. I think his name is Kramer in Philadelphia.
Larry Krasner.
Krasner.
Bell in St. Louis. There's a handful of them around the country. Liberatory DAs who
say we're going to lock up criminals instead of just people of color. It's a novel idea to lock people up. And after the Black Lives Matter protests, the police came roaring back and twisted the numbers, and have the right wing have said talk of defunding the police is causing the uptick in crime. Nobody's defunded the police anywhere, right? Maybe Austin a little, but there's been no real defunding, but that's what's causing the crime. Talk to me about the Faircloth Amendment. You mentioned it during office hours. This is outrageous.
Yes, thank you. The Faircloth Amendment relates to affordable housing, and it was passed to limit, to restrain the federal government and stop it from building new housing, which is frankly the key to resolving the affordable housing crisis that's emerged in cities across the United States. The federal government has resources that local governments don't. And local governments often don't have the capacity to, on the marketplace, compete with private developers, particularly to establish new housing, to build new projects. And that's exactly what the federal government could do, used to do, cannot do any longer due to this amendment passed in 1979 that I would like to overturn. And when I see across the United States, not a single city in which a minimum wage worker working a full-time job can afford a two-bedroom apartment for, you know, one kid, that's not okay. It is preposterous that a full-time worker is unable to afford anywhere in the United States a home. And that's a reflection of many things, including the commoditization of housing. It's a reflection of the Faircloth Amendment. It's a reflection of a lot of things. The freezing of the federal minimum wage for over a decade. You know, these are all policy factors that are driving that outcome. And I would like to frankly change all of them. And those are things that we can do through policy when we have different people making the decisions in Washington.
People who are landlords like Paul Pelosi and Nancy Pelosi, we're talking tens of millions of dollars in real estate. They can write the code, they can write the tax code, they can write the laws like the Faircloth Amendment that benefits landlords. Why does the Faircloth Amendment benefit landlords?
They can do that. They do that, and they have done that. The right. Faircloth Amendment benefits landlords by restricting housing supply and basically inflating the price of housing as a commodity good to be sold and as a thing to be rented. Now, The one thing to note here is that who ends up paying the price? In communities across the country, particularly here in San Francisco, the displacement and gentrification that has been driven by the affordable housing crisis has literally shifted the racial composition of our city. African Americans were at one point in San Francisco as many as 12% of our local population. The Black community is down to 4% here. And that doesn't even, frankly, in any way capture just how vicious it has been for our Black neighbors in San Francisco. A generation ago, through an urban renewal project in a neighborhood called the Fillmore, there was a destruction of a generation of Black wealth. And now today, in fact, over the last 50 years, but continuing today, our last Black enclave, Bayview Hunters Point, is the site of one of our state, I think our nation's worst environmental justice, environmental racism calamities. The U.S. Navy has a shipyard that for decades was poisoning the neighborhood with radiation, particularly from ships that were being cleaned after they were testing atomic bombs in the South Pacific. And to have a neighborhood where there are so many public disease vectors, things, different kinds of cancers, asthma, there's just at the moment just an effort to try to track the epidemiology of that neighborhood and establish the density of the cancer cluster there. Everybody's suing each other. The Navy's suing the property developer, who's suing the contractor who tried to clean it. There's building new housing happening there right now as we speak. And people acknowledge that the soil is toxic.
Right.
And the only person who could do anything about it is Nancy Pelosi. And her only role with respect to the poisoning of Hunter's Point was to help engineer the privatization of the land that is now poisoning the residents. And this is a pattern of policymakers putting their private profit before the public interest. And when you noted real estate investments, that's one among a series of ways in which ownership interests skew public policy. There's a long overdue debate finally happening about policymakers owning publicly traded stocks, that is to say shares in publicly traded companies. But even that has not touched, as you correctly noted, real estate investments and the conflicts of interest that they introduce, or for that matter, in investments in things like private equity instruments or hedge funds. If the public knew how policymakers were investing in hedge funds and how those hedge funds were investing in communities, I think people would be at least as outraged as they are over publicly traded stocks. At the moment in the country, one of the things that private equity firms are doing is buying up all the excess housing stock, which, to bring us full circle to your original question, is absolutely in the benefit of landlords because it's creating an artificial price bubble in the real estate market. Right. That benefits people who make $1 million a year in rental income, like Nancy Pelosi. And that's not even counting her stock trades and the insider trading and the hedge funds and the private equity. You know, being a policymaker should not be a profit-making enterprise. And if you want to make profit, you know, she's been very adamant to say it's a capitalist society. If you want to make money, go do something else. This is not a place to make money. This is supposed to be an arena to represent people and pass policies to protect people from the vagaries of the marketplace, not to exploit it for their own benefit. And that's what she's been doing for 35 years. And it is completely unethical, unacceptable. It is corrupt. And I hope to make it, I hope to bring it to an end.
Well, I think we have a mutual friend. He goes under the name Jeff Blackwood on this show. And he turned me on to capitaltrades.com. He helped your last campaign. I have a feeling he facilitated this appearance as well. Anyway, he turned me on to capitaltrades.com. If everybody goes to capitaltrades.com, and it's very easy to use. You've been there, right, Shahid?
Yeah, of course.
And look at what it's really easy to navigate. And you will go then to shahidforchange.us and give Shahid money because Pelosi has to go. It is, you know, it's criminal. It cannot be legal what Paul Pelosi is doing. It can't be legal. The trades he's making in Amazon and Apple, it cannot be legal. And if it is, then they should be arrested for being speaker and allowing it to be legal. It can't be legal.
So you sort of noted this before, the irony, the tragic irony, is that these people make the laws and they write them to their benefit. And the Stock Act was passed under President Obama in 2012, and all it requires is disclosure. Even it has been routinely violated by dozens of members of Congress, as documented by Business Insider. And it's not just the case, you know, there's two layers to this. We've talked for a little bit about some of the ways in which the, you know, with hedge funds and private equity instruments and real estate, how the pending reform proposals don't meet the need and don't stop the intrusion of the profit motive into the policymaking process. You know, even the reform proposals are limited to publicly traded stocks. But there's a whole other element here to consider, and that is that nobody's talking about how to remedy any of this. Right? Like people are talking about, fine, let's ban policymakers from trading stocks. Yes, finally, please, of course. And what do we do first about the generations of investors who've been defrauded by policymakers trading based on inside information that only they had access to, basically defrauding the marketplace? More importantly than that, what do we do about the generations of policy that have been stacked in Wall Street's favor because policymakers had a stake in the outcome and skin in the game when they were passing laws to fill their pockets instead of meeting the needs of their constituents? How do we reset that table? And what is the schedule on which we're going to revisit policies in sectors like from healthcare? You know, the Affordable Care Act was a massive subsidy to health insurance companies in which many members of Congress are invested. So if we're going to have a policy that's free of corporate influence, when are we going to revisit that, for instance, to consider it against the Medicare for All proposal that has long been favored by bipartisan majorities across the United States? There was a study by Princeton in, I think it was 2016, identifying and confirming that Congress responds more to Wall Street, to capital, than it does to we the people, to popular preferences, to constituents.
Right.
And congressional insider trading is one of the reasons why. It's not the only reason why. You know, and if we fix this, there's still going to be problems with campaign finance. There's still going to be problems with post-campaign lobbying by corporations. You know, these are all different dimensions of corporate influence, different gateways for corruption. I've had a chance to fight several of them. As a baby lawyer, I litigated the last case before the Citizens United decision that aimed to keep corporate money out of elections. And we won that case. We won the battle and then lost the war. Mm-hmm. And you know, I'm now trying to fight the war on another front. And just to be clear, because Citizens United is a constitutional decision, it might, you know, a lot of people resort to an amendment as the likely way to overturn it. An end run around that requirement is to end judicial life tenure in order to force turnover on the bench. That could shake loose some of these jurisprudential log jams that are going to have created structural challenges for our democracy. You know, these are layers of policy that I think most people, certainly our contemporary media, does not think about or consider in any way. And, you know, I've been doing this work a long time and I have some ideas on how to help. And we get in a position to do that.
Shahidforchange.us. Shahidforchange.us. Shahid for change.us. Give him money. You will feel better. All day we've been talking about what a pig Howard Schultz is, trying to bust Starbucks firing people for trying to unionize. Well, boycott Starbucks. Don't spend $7 at Starbucks. Instead, give it to shahidforchange.us. I'm not calling for a boycott of Starbucks because that will hurt the unions. But you know, once or twice a week, forego your cappuccino, frappuccino, and go to shahidforchange.us and give him money. Give him money. When you get angry at the Democrats, give him money. Trust me, it's a great release. I'm not saying hate Nancy Pelosi. I'm not saying that. But when she makes you angry, go to shahidforchange.us and give him money, $5. He was at office hours Friday. This is a bottom-up campaign. And he's taking on the Democratic establishment. The most powerful Democrat in America is Nancy Pelosi. And to some degree, they came after you last time, and it was not nice. Talk to me about nationalization. I know I want to be respectful of your time. You are the first candidate to openly talk about nationalizing the oil companies. You're a democratic socialist, correct?
I'm a socialist.
You're a socialist.
Yeah.
Isn't the pathway to socialism Congress nationalizing industry?
Yes, precisely. Yes, thank you. And it's not just a pathway to socialism. While it is, I'm more focused in this context on the pathway to climate justice. Put another way, a pathway for our species to survive the future. That is not complicated. The primacy of that need over Wall Street profit making could not be more clear. And yet, our Congress of millionaires is more concerned with filling their pockets. Now, I so appreciate you drawing attention to this because I've not heard anyone else.
You said that at office hours and on the show. I've been going, where are the calls for nationalization? I'm a leftist. I have Dr. Harriet Fraud about to join us. All we talk about is Marxist theory and the Marxist critique. There's a pathway. Nationalize these effing companies. It's
so much.
Ahmed Attlee did it.
Yes. And first of all, I'm so grateful that you see it through this lens, because I do think whatever passes for the left in the United States is a depressing specter of itself, because if it had any spine, this would be the debate. You know, we're fighting over scraps at the moment. $15 an hour? Like, give me a break. Right. And yes, just to be clear, the Green New Deal is an absolute imperative. And I particularly appreciate the just transition elements and the federal jobs guarantee. And we cannot pretend that it will be enough as long as we allow profit making from scarce natural resources that nobody can produce or replenish. And I would just note that it doesn't make any sense to allow people to sell things that they can't produce or replenish, especially in an age of scarcity, and even worse, in an age of externality where extracting these resources creates such predictable, limitless, compounding, cascading problems going forward. It is absolutely predatory to allow these industries to continue chasing the profit motive. This is another way to think about this, is that allowing the marketplace to decide how much, for instance, oil is extracted is like dialing the extraction dial to 11, because it's an incentive for anyone to get anything and sell it. Whereas once we nationalize the companies, we can do things like make democratic decisions as a people to say, well, we want to ramp this down. There's no way to ramp down extraction without seizing control of these companies. And the fact that we're not even talking about it, even in 2022, is a reflection of just how much capitalism ultimately has the throat, its hand around the throat of our democracy and the future of our species. And it's, I think, this vision and the willingness to talk about it. If I may directly address also, there's this film, Don't Look Up, everybody's talking about. And like, I'm so grateful that films are getting recognized at the Academy Awards. I'm like, can we please talk about policy for once? You know, and I'm grateful that a journalist wrote a movie and the people were talking about it, but like, can we get to policy, please? And it is particularly striking to me when the journalists who write movies who claim to care about climate won't cover the policies or the candidates proposing them. And I just don't.
The American people don't understand how corporate America works. And if you don't understand how corporate America works, you don't understand who's torturing you and how they get away with it. We don't even have to nationalize the oil companies. We just need to buy 10% of ExxonMobil. That would give us a majority, not a majority, but that would give this government the most votes in ExxonMobil. We could buy up these healthcare companies at 10%. Their market cap is, let's say, $200 billion. For $20 billion, we could own Aetna, or at least the 10%, which is more than anybody else owns. And we could say, guess what, folks? You're done. You're now. What, you're a constitutional lawyer. You went to Stanford. You graduated from Stanford. I'll give you a special dispensation on that. Is it legal for the federal government to buy stock, go to the open market and buy stock?
Absolutely. All nationalization means is exactly that. It is, you know, the due process clause of the Fifth Amendment would require compensation to shareholders of these companies, but that's exactly what.
But can't we go to, can't Social Security, there's cash sitting in Social Security. Can't the Social Security Administrator say, you know what? I want to invest in the market. We're going to take some of the money that you pay into Social Security and we're going to buy $4 billion worth of Apple stock. Is that legal?
It's legal. I mean, part of the problem here is that the federal government doesn't perceive, and in fact, it's blocked by law from perceiving its purchasing power as a lever to shift anything, not even just in terms of ownership, but even in the healthcare marketplace. You know, the government can't bargain down the cost of pharmaceuticals. That's a very like meager reflection of the same principle. And that's a policy choice. There's nothing
more. You say the laws, is there a constitutional issue of?
There was 100 years ago, there was a case, the Lochner decision, which sort of squarely poised this question of, can Congress and legislatures make economic decisions? Can they make decisions to try to craft, to engineer the marketplace? And for many years, the Supreme Court said, no, it cannot. And it started with a case about bakers in New York, and it ended in a case about hotels here in California 30 years later. And in between, FDR had to threaten the courts with their potential expansion. And ultimately the courts conceded, okay, fine. We'll let policymakers engineer the economy. And just to be clear, that's faded now into an uncontested principle. And Congress engineers the economy every day, particularly to steer wealth upward from working people into the pockets of oligarchs, millionaires like Nancy Pelosi, and the billionaires whose interests that they serve. And that happens in every way from, for instance, in 2020, when the pandemic started, Ilhan Omar from Minnesota, she had the best proposal I've heard since the pandemic started. This was the Rents and Mortgage Cancellation Act. She proposed that as long as the pandemic's happening, let's keep people at home. Let's make banks pay the cost of housing, freeze everybody's rent payments, freeze the mortgage payments. If somebody's a small landlord and they need somebody's rent payment, okay, we'll set up a government program for them. We've got the resources. And instead, what Nancy Pelosi and corporate Democrats decided to do was give the Pentagon an extra $25 billion beyond what Biden requested.
Unbelievable. It's
absolute idiocy, but idiocy where some people, more than others, end up unfortunately paying the price.
Right. I want to do two things. I would give anything to have you come back all the time. I want to give Dr. Harriet Fraud a chance to ask you a question or tell you how much she loves you. But first, go to shahidforchange.us. Shahidforchange.us. He is taking on the Pelosi dynasty, and you pay a price when you go after the Clintons, the Bidens, or the Pelosis. You pay a price for this. Support Shahid for Congress. Let's send him to Washington, D.C., and get rid of Nancy Pelosi. Get rid of Nancy Pelosi and some other Democrats. I am a Democrat, by the way. Dr. Harriet Fraud, let me unmute you, please. There you go.
I totally agree. It just makes me know that we need a revolution here, because this happens on every level where corruption, and everybody knows. You say people aren't informed. There's that song by Leonard Cohen. Everybody knows. On some level, people know that, and they shift their interest into who's having sex with who and sexual practices, where they've got to know the details. Because the place, the empire is falling, corruption is everywhere, and on some level, everybody knows. And that's why what I was going to talk about today is so hopeful, what the Amazon victory. Because everybody knows, and they are acting on it, and they won. And when Chris Smalls and Derek Palmer declare, this is the revolution. They aren't the AFL-CIO. They aren't the retail workers union whose head Applebaum is getting $337,014 a year, while the highest paid workers are getting a tenth of that at Amazon. But, you know, I think people have to have hope, and we have to have a really strong socialist party where it's like the pole of an umbrella with all the spokes joined at the top for climate change, for Medicare for all, for quality childcare, for Black Lives Matter, for civil rights, for women's rights in the marketplace, for maternity care and maternity and paternity leaves, but all under one powerful umbrella, which is the mass of people of America.
Right. Let me do this. Let me have Shahid respond, and then I want him to come back. So I want to be respectful of his time. Let me give you the last word, and then when you're gone, I will try to get more money raised for you. So
you're very kind. I appreciate a chance to be with you and Dr. Fraud, your analysis. You know, I think we are living at a time that is a crux in human history. We see this already, the acceleration of the pace of technology, how it's changed social norms, how it's disrupted entire industries, displaced families and communities, and created a lot of opportunities for some and a lot of pain for others. And we know that this acceleration is frankly only going to continue. Mm-hmm. And we know some of the ways in which it's going to continue. It's going to get really dry here in the West. It's going to get hot. People aren't going to have a lot of water. And a lot of islands in the Pacific are going to be gone. Miami's going to be underwater, right? We know all this. And we can either make decisions informed by the science, or we can act like idiots and just fill our pockets and race the future off a cliff, which is what Congress has been doing for the last however many years. And
those who are filling their pockets can continue while the mass is immiserated.
Well, yes, though, I mean, just to push back, I don't think it's a few. This is, I mean, not to bite off a whole chunk here, but this is one of the tragic ironies of like 401k programs, right? Where people gain infinitesimal shares in companies and they come to identify with the interests of capital, even if they are being ground under its heels. And, you know, this, the Stockholm syndrome that has captured the American middle class and the extent to which Americans think that our futures are bound up with the interests of Wall Street when they could not in any more obviously be in opposition. The co-optation, you might say, of working America has been profound. And if I were to draw any, there was one theme where you talked about Chris Smalls and Derek and the Amazon, and I'm so excited for their victories and the Starbucks unionizations. Just to riff on that, if I may, we have some supporters, volunteers here in our campaign who are active in the Starbucks unionizing wave in the Central Coast. I'm so incredibly proud of them. I want to shout one of them out who's running for state assembly. His name's Joseph Thompson. Super proud of that young man. Incredibly inspiring young labor leader. If you're looking,
bring him on. I'd love to.
Yeah, he'd be a great guest for your program.
I'd love that. Please.
And then, and I want to also just riff on a piece that Dr. Fraud said with respect to contrasting Chris with the AFL-CIO. It's such an important contrast. A month ago, maybe a month and a half, SEIU, major labor union, endorsed Pelosi without a vote, without any opportunity for its rank and file to participate. And rank and file members came to us and said, this is BS. We want you in this meeting. They get me into the Zoom. I post the analysis. They never got to hear. And, you know, the union leadership disables the chat, of course. But the idea that labor unions are becoming rolled and complicit in the aggrandizement of Wall Street and corporate politicians, abandoning the interests of their own rank and file, is really problematic here. And I just want to point out that the battle for workplace democracy starts in the workplace, and it continues into labor unions and into the political parties that they support if the members push it there. And so I'm really excited by this wave of workplace unionization, and I hope that it continues beyond the workplace. And that's a really exciting opportunity that I'm eager to see. And thank you so much for having me on again today, David.
Thank you, Shahid. And please come back, and please bring anybody you want. We're for you 100%. Go to shahidforchange.us. Thank you so much, Shahid. Thank you.
Bye, all.